on the Father that dwells in us. All right? So because it's Holy Ghost service, I want to talk to you about the Father that dwells in us. The Father that dwells in us. If I were you, I would say dwells in me. So it will be personal every time you read it. The Father that dwells. It's important for you to see, I say dwells, not visits. This Father is not a guest in me. He remains. He has taken his home in me. Okay? I'm his host. 3 weeks ago, I said God has two addresses. You remember? I said one in heaven, another one is me. All right? He dwells in me. You know, if... come on, are you here? When you read the whole Bible, pay attention now. When you read the whole Bible, there is a certain theme you're going to find in the scriptures. You will find that God, first Genesis, he makes man, and then he comes in the cool of the day for fellowship. Okay? Man falls, God drives him out of the garden. And I like to say what Adam and Eve missed from the garden was not the fruits. Do you understand? Because they went to another side and started farming again. It's not the fruits they missed. What they missed was fellowship. Okay? They were sent out. Now, see here, after they are sent out, God longs to a fellowship with man. All right? He longs to bring them back to that experience again. Please follow this line of, it's a foundation. Once you get it, the rest of my teaching will be easy for you. So he drives them out. Okay? Now you have people like Seth, all the way to men like Enoch, who are now in fellowship with God, and all they know is the voice of God. And then God brings in a man called Abraham. Pay attention. When Abraham came, God wants to restore man. So he says, let's enter covenant. You know why? So that what belongs to Abraham belongs to me. And what belongs to me is Abraham's. And from Abraham is where you have the children of Israel. But don't forget, there was a time the world got sinful because of the fallen angels. I'm just saving time. The fallen angels came down and had fellowship with children of men, women particularly, and they corrupted the whole race except Noah's. Okay? Noah and his three boys and their wives too. But watch this. While God is planning to destroy the whole humanity with flood, he preserves three men. Okay? Four actually, plus Noah. So when they come out of that ark, Bible said, with these three sons of Noah, God overpopulated the earth. Are you following? Three men. But here's a line of thought I want you to see. Now, when now you finally have Jacob, and Jacob, do you remember what God called Jacob? He said, you'll no longer be Jacob, you will be Israel. He said, you're no longer an individual, you are a nation. But you must see something. It's a reason why most of the teachings we have a lot of Jewish culture. You understand? And people listening to us, they are thinking, isn't your God not African? Why is there so much Jewish in everything you teach? Listen to me today, I'll tell you the reason why. Because salvation is first to the Jews. Then to the Gentiles. All right? But then Paul showed us something. He said, you're not a Jew outwardly. In other words, you can be born by a Jewish parent, whatever, but you might not be a Jew. Paul said, a Jew is not one outwardly. No, you become Jewish by your faith in Jesus Christ. The real children of Abraham are children of faith. Do you understand it now? Yes. So Jesus is not Jewish. He is not. He is Lord of all. Hallelujah. Here's a theme I want to pick from this story. When now God picks Israel as a nation, he takes them into Egypt. Are you following? I'm literally showing you the entire Bible in a minute. Takes them into Egypt. Now they are overtaxed there and all these harsh things. And God sends someone called who? Moses. Now here's where the big thing begins. Because when God takes Moses, Kelvin, and he begins to journey with Moses from Egypt, Egypt is a type of the world. It's called the house of bondage. You're here? It's called the house of bondage. So he begins to journey with them to Canaan. Canaan is the promised land. It's a type of Christ. Do you understand? Because that Canaan they are going to, Abraham was there before them. They are not going to displace people in their land. It is their land. Do you understand now? Because God said, I promised to your fathers this land. So the guys dwelling there don't own the land. It belongs to these guys. The only reason they are not there is because famine drove them to. Do you understand it now? Now you have, in the wilderness, God begins to talk to Moses. And he says, hey Moses, I've been visiting you guys, but I want to talk to you about something. He said, come up the mountain. I want you to go down and make something God called tabernacle. Please don't miss this. He said, make a tabernacle where me and you can commune. He said, make for me a tent so that I might dwell among you. All right? So they make a tent, they make a tabernacle where God will come down, his glory will come down, and he will talk with people. But don't forget, these are shadows. Are you here? You will understand in a minute where I'm going with this. These are shadows. So he makes a tent for them, and they have to carry it in the camp. God comes and fellowships with them. All right? Long story short, he makes an ark, which represents again the presence of God. Okay? And you remember the days of David? They still had the ark. Okay? Are you here? They still had the ark. But then, do you remember what the blind Bartimaeus was crying, saying? What was he calling Jesus? Son of who? How can he call Jesus son of David? I'm going to show you how David features in the New Testament. Because there's something the book of Revelation calls the keys of David. Yes. I'm going to show you how it features. Because David is not just a king. David is also a priest. Now you're jumping to where you're kings and priests. David, you're here? When Uriah touched the ark wrong way, he was killed. David ate the food offered in the temple and gave his men and did die. When Saul offered sacrifice, God rejected him. David, I want to show you something about that man. All right? Why he features in the New Testament. Now watch. David, are you here? David now is dealing with the ark and all that. But Bible is saying something. One day when God had given David peace all around, it came into his heart. Listen to me and listen hard. It came into his heart to build for God a temple. Now, here's where things get interesting. He said, I want to build you a temple. And God said, hey David, since I brought you from Egypt, I've only been in tents. Okay? He said, what house will you build for me, David? He said, I don't dwell in temples and tents made with hands. Where do you dwell, God? I'll show you where he dwells. If he can be in what has been made with hands. Okay? So David said, I want to build a house for you. And so Prophet Nathan came. He said, okay. And David shared the vision. And Nathan said, all right, let me seek the Lord about it. And the Lord said, all right, it's a good thing, but tell David he can build for me. Why? Because he's been in fights. His hands with a lot of blood. His son Solomon will build for me. So David said, okay, I'll prepare for the building. Okay? And Solomon built the temple. Do you remember that when Jesus showed up, he compared himself to Solomon? Do you remember Jesus said that greater than Solomon is here? They compare in so many things. Jesus came to build the temple. Solomon built the temple. Jesus is the wisdom of God. Jesus is what Solomon received. Do you understand it now? Now, he builds a temple. 46 years. But let me jump to where now, oh God, I wish I had 16 hours to show this to you. Let me jump to where they are dedicating the temple. And Solomon, I told you there's something about these two kings. Okay, talk about David, talk about Solomon, another I can mention for you. Because these guys are not just kings. No. No, these guys can also pray. Alright? So Solomon is praying. And Bible said, when he was done praying, this is a book of Kings. Bible said, the glory of the Lord fills the temple. So much the priest could not go in to minister. Alright? Now, Prophet Haggai told you something. He said, the glory of this latter house shall be greater than the former. Now, let me jump quickly so that I can tell you, the latter house is not a physical building. When Jesus showed up, are you here? The disciples were excited and they wanted to show Jesus the temple their fathers built. They said, oh, Jesus, see how beautiful this temple has been. We've been worshiping here. And to their surprise, Jesus said, destroy this temple. And I'll build it in 3 days. They said, what? It took us 46 years to build this. And Bible told us he was talking about his body. Alright? So you see now, Jesus came to build a different temple. Jesus actually built for God what God said. He doesn't dwell in temples made with hands. So Jesus saw that need of the Father and built him a temple that is not made with hands. Jesus has built for God a mobile temple, a talking temple, a touching temple. Oh, are you here? You see, in the Old Testament, when they brought sacrifices, they brought dead animals. In the New Testament, we bring living sacrifices, live animals. In the Old Testament, you want to kill a god and then offer it dead. Now I offer my life, living with life. I'm quoting Romans 12:1 for you. So Jesus sent something over in Hebrews. Let me have your Bible, Kelvin, so I can rush through this. Hallelujah. Do you understand why that foundation is necessary now? Yes, because now God, Jesus has been building, he has been building a temple. Okay? Now, in the book of Hebrews, okay, he said something over in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews 10:5. Look at verse 4. Let's use the NIV. Because it is impossible, for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin. See, when they offered all this, it didn't take away sin. All it did was to cover sin. Alright? And because sin was covered, there was a reminder of it. They always remember. That's why they did it often, because it only covered. The Lamb of God doesn't cover sin. He takes it away. He blots it out. You understand this? Now he says, the bulls, the blood of bulls and goats to take away sin. Verse 5 quickly. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body. A body you prepared for me. Alright? Now, what is a man saying? One, he is saying he is a sacrifice. Are you here? That's what he's saying. He's saying he is a sacrifice. But another thing I want you to see here is that while the Father prepared a body, Jesus prepared a body too for him. Talk to me now. The Father prepared a body. Okay? And Jesus came in that body. And when Jesus showed up, he prepared a body for the Father that I'm now talking to you about. Because you see, before Mount Sinai, before glory and all that, God said, 3 days sanctify yourself. Hmm? 3 days sanctify yourself before I can show up on Mount Sinai. And before the Holy Ghost shows up and brings you to Mount Zion, 3 years Jesus must show up. Are you listening to me? 3 years he must bridge the gap. Prepare you. The era of the church is the era of the Holy Ghost. It's not the era of Jesus. The era of Jesus is what is coming. Now is the time for the Holy Spirit. Jesus is coming. His time is coming. Alright? His time is coming. But now is the Holy Spirit reigning in all of you. But Jesus had to show up for 3.5 years. Prepare you. Because the Holy Spirit, over in Ezekiel 36, before God said, I can put my spirit within you, I must clean you first. Did you see that? I must clean you first, sprinkle you with blood, then I'll put my spirit within you. So before that happens, the sacrifice must be offered. I'll show you from scriptures now. Alright? So the point I've been saying for the last 10 minutes is that God has prepared us a body. We are the body of Jesus Christ. So who is the Father that dwells in us? Answer me. Let me see whether you've been following us. The Holy Spirit. Good students, is the Holy Spirit. Now write this down. The Holy Spirit is the gift and the promise of the Father. The Holy Spirit is a gift and the promise of the Father. Now, Isaiah 44, verse 3. I'll tell you when I need it next. Isaiah 44, verse 3. Glory to God. After today's service, anything you touch will turn to gold. Are you understanding me? Anything you touch, anything you touch, something will happen to it. Isaiah 44. For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty. Glory to God. You see, when we were growing up, Eve, we were told something. We were told if you spend a day or 2 days or 3 days without reading the word of God, how we were brought up, you felt guilty. If you didn't study the word of God, you were guilty, because it was taught in such a way in church that that was an offense. Okay? That was a sin. But then as I grew up in the word, I found out when I don't study the word of God, the feeling I get is not guilt. It's hunger. If I miss my breakfast, am I guilty? I'm hungry. You understand me? Now, like you have, when you miss taking water, is it guilt that takes you to the... What takes you there? Thirst. You see? So I eat the word of God because I desire it. It's a natural thing in me. I don't do it out of guilt. I'm thirsty for it and I go take water. Hungry for it and I go feed on the word. Are you here? Said, I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, and floods upon the dry ground. Glory to God. Floods are pouring in here. I will pour my spirit upon your seed. You see, when water comes on the seed, fruitfulness will resort. Are you hearing me? There will be fruitfulness. He said, upon your seed, and my blessing upon your offering. See, the Holy Spirit is a blessing. It's a blessing. All right? Yes. The world says the rain is a blessing. In the spiritual things, there is another rain which is also a blessing. Glory to God. That's the Holy Spirit too. He said, I'll pour my spirit, I'll pour water upon him that is thirsty, floods on him that is... This is the promise of the Father. Okay? This is the promise of the Father. Look at verse 4 quickly. He said, and they shall spring up. When water is poured on the seed, they will spring up as among the grass. as willows by the water courses. Peter told you, First Peter told you, all flesh is as grass. So he's talking about people. This prophetic language is people he's talking about. Right? Yes. Hallelujah. Another way of saying it prophetically is trees. Sometimes we call people trees. So you'll hear Isaiah say things like trees of the field were clapping. He's talking about people. When he says mountains and hills, talking about authorities. Are you here? For example, Isaiah 61, he said, you will be called the planting of the Lord, the tree of righteousness. Why he calls you the tree is because you have fruits. You are also a tree because it is seed that was sown in you. Glory to God. Now he says something here. He says, they shall spring up as among the grass, as willows by the water courses. Verse 5. I must show this to you. One shall say, I am the Lord's. Another shall call himself by the name of the Lord. See, this is evangelism. People are now identifying with Jesus. They're getting born again. This is what happens when the Holy Spirit is poured. Okay? By the name of Jacob, another shall subscribe with his heart unto the Lord and surname himself by the name of his. These are the last days we're going into. Alright? People getting born again and born again and born again because of what they are seeing in your life. Alright? But this is the work of the Holy Spirit. So that's one. Second scripture, Joel 2:28. Quickly, let me show another promise of the Father. Joel 2:28. And it shall come to pass that after I will pour my spirit, okay, upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. Are you hearing me? Now, you should be experiencing all these three. All right? Now, you know what amazed me is that this is a prophetic word that was fulfilled in the book of Acts chapter 2, and yet this prophetic word didn't capture speaking in tongues. Alright? They didn't capture it. The one that captured it was Isaiah. Alright? But when they started speaking in tongues, they started prophesying. Alright? And they started seeing visions. These are dreams as a result of the coming of the Holy Spirit. See, those are different dreams now. Alright? Because the Holy Spirit is inspiring the dreams. Alright? That's what happens. So this is a promise of the Father. Now, look at Acts 1 quickly and verse 4. Use CEV quickly. Acts 1, 4. I am rushing somewhere. While this is Jesus, he was still with them. He said, don't leave Jerusalem yet. Wait here for the Father to give you the Holy Spirit, just as I told you, he has promised to do. You see, Jesus, you know, quotes from that promise again. He said, wait for the promise of the Father, who is the Holy Spirit. So that now in Acts chapter 2, Peter says to us, he says, what you see now is a prophecy of Prophet Joel. Okay? The next chapter 2, he will tell you, this is a fulfillment of the prophetic word. Okay? So I've shown you that now that's the gift and the promise. Can you see it now? So it's a promise of the Father. The Holy Spirit is a promise of the Father. Now write this statement down so you don't forget it. The ministry of the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament was to a measure. The ministry of the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament was to a measure. Just to a measure. The Holy Spirit could only come upon them, but he would never dwell in them. Alright? He could only come upon them. Just upon them. Are you here? I'm talking to you about who? The Father that dwells in you. There's a Father in you. Glory to God. You know why that is so? It's the reason why you are so persuaded God is your Father. Because of that Father in you, who has made it clear to you that you are a Father. But he is on another mission to let you experience the Father's love for you. So you also know that the Father loves you because of the Father that's in you. Okay? Now, I say the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament was to a measure. He could only come upon them, but he would never dwell in them. Now, okay. In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit, or the power of the Holy Spirit, was resting on three guys, three offices. Okay? Number one, the priest. Only these guys had the anointing. Number two, the king. All right? And number three, the prophet. Okay? So you'll fight on those guys. You'll fight the anointing of God on Aaron. You'll fight the anointing of God on King David. You fight the anointing of God on the prophets. All right? Yes. You fight it. And you find men like Samson with the spirit of might. Bible said the spirit had to come upon him for him to do all those things. Same things for every other man you have in the Bible. The spirit of God had to come upon them and then they will act. Even when we read last Sunday, when Samuel was releasing Saul, he said the Holy Spirit will come upon you. Remember? He said, do as the occasion serves. Don't act before that. But he could never dwell in them. Okay? Never. And let me show you why that is so. John 7. John 7, verse 37. He would never dwell in them. Okay, let's use the passion. Then, look up, everyone, so you don't miss this. Then, on the most important day of the feast, the last day, Jesus stood and shouted out to the crowds, all you thirsty ones, come to me. Come to me and drink. Is that what we read in Isaiah? That he said, I'll pour water on the thirsty. And Jesus said, hey, I've been looking for the thirsty. John told you I baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. Now I have the Holy Spirit. Where are the thirsty folks? I'm looking for them. When he showed up at the well with the Samaritan woman, they are at the well. And Jesus said, I give wells. He said, this water you're fetching, you'll be thirsty again, woman. I have water you don't know about. If you knew who's talking to you, you'd ask him for the gift of God. Because the gift of God is not just salvation. No, he said, with joy, you draw from the wells of salvation. Salvation has wells from where you draw. Okay? You draw from those wells. So he says, who is thirsty? Come to me and drink. Are you here? Come to me and drink. Hallelujah. And I drink every day. Are you here? I drink every day. When things are giving me pressure, I take one or two every morning. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Yes. Doesn't matter what pressure is around me. You see, this one has no hangover. Do you understand me? I don't wake up feeling like I need, you know, painkillers and all that. No, no, no. In fact, I'm addicted to this one. Yes, sir. Glory to God. And it is a habit I don't want to lose. Hallelujah. When I meet with my fellow drunkards on a Saturday morning like this. Glory to God. Are my drunkards present this morning? Yes, when you're drunk with the Holy Spirit, you talk sense. Are you hearing me? Yes, you make sense. So much sense. And it's amazing, some of the things you do under the influence of the Holy Spirit, you not do them otherwise. Glory to God, you not do them otherwise. Now he says, then on the most important day, Jesus said, oh, you thirsty, come to me. Come to me and drink. Look at verse 38, please. Believe in me so that rivers of living water will burst out from within you, flowing from your innermost being, just like the scripture says. Verse 39 is why I read this for you. Jesus was prophesying about the Holy Spirit that believers were being prepared. I told you there was a preparation before you would show up.
Yeah.
Now you see it. They were being prepared to receive him. Alright? Then he says, but the Holy Spirit had not yet been poured out upon them because Jesus had not yet been unveiled in his full spread. In other words, he had not died for them. Salvation wasn't possible now. Okay? But you see, all that happened and the Holy Spirit came on that Pentecost day and he's been with us since. Glory to God. The good thing with the Holy Spirit is that he has come to live with me forever. Forever. Through eternity. Okay? Through eternity. He's come to be with me. Now, look at John 3:34. Stick with the same version of the Bible. Because I said the Holy Spirit will come to a measure on the guys in the Old Testament. What about the generation of Jesus? Are you here? Look at this. The one whom God has sent represents him and will speak the words of God, for God has poured out upon him the fullness of the Spirit without what? Limitation. You see? Without measure. The Holy Spirit has been poured into us without measure. No limit. Okay? No limit. In fact, use the Amplified Bible so they will see where you have without limitation. For he whom God has sent speaks the words of God. For God gives the gift of the Spirit without measure, generously and boundlessly. What does the classic say? Without, you know, boundaries. Okay? God does not give his Spirit sparingly or by measure, but boundless is the gift God makes of his Spirit. Alright? It's only you that limits the scope of the Holy Spirit in your life. God has not limited him. Alright? He's given him freely and boundlessly. Hallelujah. So that's just to show you there's a difference. Okay? Now, remind me the subject again. What are we learning again? Now, let me help you again. Because you're going, in a minute, you're going to take your Bible and you will find where, you'll find where Jesus said, the Father which is in heaven. Alright? And then you remember Pastor said the Father dwells in us. And then you'll be thinking, what is this? Are there two fathers? No, it's the same Father. Okay? It's the same Father. I want to make that distinction for you. Okay? Now, Luke 11. I want to first show you the Father which is in heaven. Then I'll show you the Father that dwells in you. All right? You see, when you listen to maybe worship experiences, teachings, how the body of Christ has been brought up is there is a common phrase, the throne room. Okay? The throne room. And so, because of that common phrase, people get the idea that when you go to heaven, there is a room somewhere, okay, where is some sort of the place where the Father is, he dwells. That's the throne. It's a room. All right? Now, that's not what the Bible teaches. No. That's not what the Bible teaches. As a matter of fact, are you here? As a matter of fact, the throne of God, are you here? God, the Father, are you here? Pay attention so that nisikie munanipata, eh? The throne of God, that seat of God, Papa God, Big Daddy, the Father himself, has never stood up from that seat. Okay? But there's something with that throne. That throne moves. Oh, you read in your Bible that he has cherubims with wings, 6 of them. 6 wings. And 2 cover 2 wings for these cherubims. Cherubims are angels, all right? But in another class, they have 6 wings. 2 wings they cover their eyes with, all right? Other 2 wings are to fly. And these other 2 wings, they cover the mercy seat and all that. They have 2 to cover themselves because of the glory of the Father, which keeps changing every time you look at it. Are you here? Now, heaven does not have sun. You know why? Because this your sun casts shadows. There are no shadows. Do you understand this now? There is a light that lights that city. It's not this sun. Okay? So Bible told you that the Father, there is no shadow in him. No shadow. No shadow. But I am quoting from Revelation. Okay? I'm quoting from Revelation. Just so that you don't think Pastor is giving you some fantasy things. Look at Revelation. Hello. Abishai, do you have me on this one? Revelation, eh? Glory to God. I want to teach you a few things about the throne of God. Glory to God. Okay. Are you here? And the city had what? Please say it louder. Had what? No need. Now, this city has no needs, in fact. All right? This is just one of the needs. It's only down here that you have needs. All right? Had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it. For the glory of God did what? Lighten it. And the Lord is what? The Lamb is what? The light thereof. Okay? How about the next verse? And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it, and the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor into it. Blah, blah, blah. Go study for yourself. Now you see, heaven. Hello? Can I go deeper with these guys? Yes. All right, let me explain this to you in real now terms. Like Jesus, you know, his disciples one day when Jesus was getting ready to go to heaven in John 16, he began to teach them. They said, wow, now you're speaking plainly. You should have started talking to us this way from since in John 16. Now let me talk plainly. When Jesus died and they buried his body in the tomb, you remember? That grave laid it there. And then Bible said Jesus resurrected. John and Peter went to visit him. You remember what they found? His clothes folded. Alright? The clothes they wrapped him with. Folded and put somewhere. Alright? Well, when Jesus showed up, he wasn't naked. Talk to me now. He left his clothes in the grave, but he wasn't naked. All right? He wasn't naked. But there's something else. When they pierced him on the cross, remember what came out? Water and blood. When he showed up and he knew Thomas didn't believe, he said, hey, Thomas, I heard you didn't believe I'm risen. He said, Thomas, I'm not a ghost. Touch me and see. Ghosts don't have what? Flesh, what else? bones. Didn't say blood. He said flesh and bones like I do. Where is the blood? You have to read Hebrews 10 to see it. Hebrews 10 says he entered heaven itself with his own blood. So you say, what flows in that body he had that day? His life. What flows in that body is life, which is light. Okay. I want you to meditate on everything I'm saying now. Eh? What flows in his body is not just blood. Now, is the Bible says Jesus is the light of life. So what flows in him is light. Now watch. That will help you understand why, with doors and windows shut, Jesus stood in their midst. Okay? It helps you understand. Because even in the natural world, you have light that see through walls. You following now? Yes. It's only sunlight that can be blocked. We can put you under x-ray and all that, and they can see through to your bones. But you see, the word of God is light penetrating to the dividing of the soul and the spirit. The word of God, once we put you on that table and light the word, it sees the bones, after bones goes to the soul, then to the spirit. Okay? Now imagine this is the word of God, and there is a man who is the word of God. How penetrating is he? So Bible says when the man spoke, his words were permeating them. Okay, let me show you this. It's in the Bible. Luke 4:32. Use the Passion, please. So I can show this to you. If you only knew, this is the body waiting for you. Is the body prepared for you? I'll show you by scriptures now. Look at this. Use the Passion. Thank you. You've been somewhere, my son, now. His teaching stunned and dazed them, for he spoke with what? Penetrating word. In other words, when you heard him, his words got somewhere. And on the day of Pentecost, Peter stood up to preach. His words too were penetrating. Because they were not empty words. They were entering their hearts. They were heavy when they heard them. And Stephen is another man. When Stephen began to speak, because they could not study his words, they picked stones. Because when the man talks, his words are strong. Yes. You didn't speak empty words. Are you here? So you see, the house closed and all that, and Jesus stood in their midst. Alright? Stood in their midst because of his kind of body. Right? It's a glorified body. But you know something? Huh? Can I tell you something? As exciting as that revelation is, put Ephesians 5, Abishai, King James, verse 30. Hello? Are you seeing what I'm seeing? For we are members of his body, of his flesh, of his bones. Same bones I've been talking to you about. Huh? Same bones that carry his life. He said you're members, you're part of them. And this is the same language you have in Genesis. The same language you have when Adam looked at his wife and he said, bone of my bones. He didn't say bones of my bones. He said, bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. He didn't also say blood. Yeah. Remember? Yeah. The Bible is very consistent. Okay? Because that's his wife. And this is the wife of the second Adam. Do you understand it now? Very consistent. So this is the second Adam. And the last one, I should say, second and last. There's no third Adam. Alright? And this one too. Alright? This one has a wife. Okay? Yes. This one has a wife. While the first Adam is told from the tree of life, blah blah, you should not eat from the tree of life. My husband is life. He is life. I'm so united with him, my fruits. Do you understand? He is the vine, I'm the branch. We are one. United to him and giving birth to fruits. Fruits are on me. I'm the fruit bearing part. Do you understand this? I'm the part that bears fruit. I wish this was the teaching. I would go all the way to that. So I want to show you that the body Jesus came back with is not like your usual body. Now, there is a Father which is in heaven. Luke 11:2. Luke 11:2. So I can differentiate this. And he said to them, when you pray, say, our Father who is in heaven. You see, when you're praying, that's the Father you pray to. You don't pray to Jesus. You don't pray to the Holy Spirit. This is the one you pray to, the Father. Right? The Father who is in heaven. But you pray in the name of Jesus by the help of the Holy Spirit. See how all of them feature in? And then you have the Father. It's the one you address the prayer to. Because Jesus prayed to him too. Alright? Mm-hmm. So that's the Father. Look at Matthew 16:17. Just some quick examples to show this to you. Here is where Peter catches a revelation who Jesus is. And watch what Jesus said. Jesus answered and said, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed this to you, but who? My Father, who is where? In heaven. Okay? Now, let me show you where both of them are involved. Alright? I want to show you a scripture where you have the Father in heaven and you have the Father that dwells in us. Can I do that? Okay. Now, Luke 11 and verse 13. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? Use the NIV. If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give you who? The Holy Spirit to those who ask him. Can you see the two now? Yeah. There is a Father in heaven who is giving the Holy Spirit. Yeah. See, those are two different entities. Alright? Yes. So that it distinguishes for you. Another quick example is when Jesus is being baptized. Get it? Maybe in the book of Luke somewhere. Luke chapter 3 or is it 4? So you can see all these three. The Trinity is something we must take time and study one of these days. Okay. Now, as soon as Jesus was baptized, now, see Jesus, the Son. Hello? Come on. You grew up saying all these things. We have got the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, I want to show you where three of them are involved. Okay? And as soon as Jesus, who is that? The Son. He went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, letting you know where this one is coming from. Heaven was open and he saw the Spirit of God. Can you see the Holy Spirit? Uh-huh. The Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting on him. Now, up to there we have two. We have the Son, we have the Holy Spirit. Go to the next verse so you can see the other one. And a voice from heaven said, see the one that is talking now. He said, this is my Son. Who can call someone my Son? Mm-hmm. See? Now that's the Father. So you see the three of them. The Son being baptized, the Holy Spirit coming down, and the Father speaking. All right? So when I say the Father dwells us, I'm referring to the Holy Spirit that has come to stay in you. He dwells in you. Glory to God. So let me show you now. I have showed you the Father in heaven. I've showed you the three of them. Let me show you now the Father that dwells in you. From there, we now take maybe a part B of this. John 14 and verse 10. Use NIV. Don't switch. That's NIV. John 14, this is verse what? Okay. Before we get to verse 10, let's go to verse 7. If you really knew me, you would have known my Father. From now on, you do know him, and I've seen him. Okay? Now, let me say a statement that will help you from today to understand the Trinity real quick. Jesus is the Father in the flesh. Jesus is a Father that can be touched. Is a Father that can be handled. If you say to God, show me you. Show me you, and you want to see with these eyes, you will see Jesus. Alright? Jesus is the tangibility of God. Alright? He's a Father that can be handled. Jesus is the body. It's a body that the Father dwells in. Do you understand this? Hallelujah. That's why the one seated on the throne is both the Father and Jesus. Because when you sit down, it's your body that occupies the seat. But you're one with that person. So you read Revelation, it says the Lamb of God came from the midst of the throne. John told you, no one has seen the only begotten Son in the presence, in the bosom of the Father. He has declared him. So in heaven, you don't see two seats. One big one and then a small one for the Father. And then the rest of you have, you know, small ones. So we are seated with Christ. That's ignorance. You understand? Just one throne. Just one. Bible said the Lord your God is what? One. He just one. Okay? Now, he is the image, blah, blah. That's wonderful. So he is the embodiment of the Father. He's the Father that can be touched. Am I making sense? So John 10, 14, pardon me, verse 7, we saw something there. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and you have seen him. He's saying to Kina Philip, you know, look at verse 8. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough. Because he said in verse 6, no one comes to the Father except by me. Philip said, I want to know that Father so I can get where he is. All right? Show me that Father. Verse 9, don't you know me, Philip? Philip said, show me the Father. Jesus said, don't you know me? What is he saying? He said, if you know me, Philip, you know my Father. Over in John 10, 30, he said, I and my Father are what? One again. He said, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I've been among you such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. Is that simple? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Verse 10 is where I'm going now. Don't you believe that I'm in the Father and the Father is in me? That's what makes us one. All right? Then he says, the words I say to you are not just my own. Rather, it is the Father, watch that, living in me. See? He lets us know the Father now dwells in him. The Father living in me who is doing the work. Do you realize that there is no miracle recorded in the ministry of Jesus until the Holy Spirit came? Not one single miracle. Until he came. Because he's a doer of the miracles. Okay? Including the words he just spoke, the Holy Spirit inspired them. You understand? Until the Holy Spirit came, no miracle. When he showed up, explosive ministry. We start wine, water to wine, cripples. When the Holy Spirit shows up, the supernatural breaks forth. That's just how it is. Alright? That's why I can't understand folks that have the Holy Spirit and they are still normal. So what's wrong with you? How can you have the Holy Spirit and not doing exploits? They even say, mimi ni mutu wa kawaida. You continue being mutu wa kawaida. Utapata shida sizizo za kawaida. You understand? The problems will be upgraded for you. Now you see, he is one with the Father. The Holy Spirit is the one that dwells in you. Now, when I now quote scriptures like 1 John 4, you of God, little children, greater is he that is in you. Who is that? Answer me now. It is the Holy Spirit. Okay? He is the one that is in you. He is the greater one in you. See? I could have easily said the God that dwells in us, and it will be the Holy Spirit. Okay? I just chose to bring you the understanding that he is the Father. Alright? He is the Father. Now, let me say something else here. The Holy Spirit, I have taught you this, but it bears repeating. The Holy Spirit has no name of himself. Okay? The Holy Spirit is not his name. No, it's not. No, that just describes him. Not just his personality. It's not his name. Okay? Yes. He is holy. He is a spirit. Do you understand it now? Yes. He doesn't have a name. That's why you read the New Testament. You'll find they'll keep changing, not changing really, giving you different names for him. Sometimes they'll call him the Spirit of Christ. And you're thinking, who is this? Other times they'll say, the Spirit of Truth. Say, who is this? The Spirit of the Father. Who is this? Sometimes they even call him the Anointing. No difference. It's the same one. Okay? Just that he is dynamic. You understand me? He is dynamic. For example, I can pick on one, the Spirit of Truth, oh God, and I can talk to you on that one. That aspect of him, of the Spirit of Truth, is big, it's huge. You know what that means, Kelvin? The Spirit of Truth, truth there means reality. Yeah. It means the scriptures takes form, becomes real, manifests when the Holy Spirit is involved. It means when you're reading the Bible and the Holy Spirit is there with you, interacting with you, the scriptures take shape. He reveals, awakens, and brings the reality of the word to you. Just like he does with the fatherhood of God. He makes it real to you. Okay? So when I say, now you read a scripture earlier on that said he is the truth-giving spirit. All right? The truth-giving spirit. In other words, you cannot even understand this Bible without the Holy Spirit. Forget it. It takes the Holy Spirit to understand it. And some using their mind to understand and teach it have run into error. Okay? Because these are truths. Sometimes, most of the times, most of the times, are you listening to me? Most of the times, spiritual truths are first believed, then understood. Glory to God. For example, as a man, I can never understand our virgin God pregnant. But as a new creature, it makes perfect sense for me. See, by faith we understand the worlds were framed by the word of God. See, unless scientists are using faith, they'll never understand it. Huh? Yes. Because after you've attended the science class, you go now to the faith class. You understand this? Faith doesn't fight science. Now, faith explains science. Are you here? Yes. That's why we pastors work closely with doctors. Because if you don't believe that the word of faith is able to heal you, others will say, oh God, we'll guide that tablet. No, guide that injection. Okay, let's use the doctors. All right? But there's a place where physicians fail and the great physician shows up. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Hallelujah. Now, so he has no name of himself. Okay? But now, since he has no name of himself, and he is living in us, he is on the world, he is in the world, he is in the earth, what name does he answer to? Alright? Which is that name, if I call it, the one that will respond will be the Holy Spirit. Okay? Can we fight that name?
Yes, sir.
All right. Let's look at it. It's here, John 14. Look at verse 26. But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in whose name? I can just stop there and it will explain everything. Alright? It's like if I called Eve and I said, attend such a meeting on my behalf. And I gave her something to present there. Alright? Or maybe they were giving presents or awards. And I say, attend that meeting and receive my present for me. Now, as she's in that meeting and they call the name Ben, who will show up? The guy giving present will say, no, you are a lady. Ben is a man. I say, he sent me. I came in his name. And I can do much more as to allow her to even sign where I was required to sign. Do you understand this? Or to even speak on my behalf. Okay? So that's what the Holy Spirit does. Okay? The Father sends him and he acts on his behalf. All right? But he responds to the name Jesus. Okay? Now, use the Amplified, please. The 2015 one. So you can see this.
Mm-hmm.
But the Helper, the Comforter, the Advocate. Okay? The Intercessor, the Counselor, the Strengthener, the Standby, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. Look at this part. In my place. See it? To represent me. To act. Talk to me now. The Holy Spirit can act on behalf of Jesus. I thought he's only speaking for him. He can act for him too. Yes. To act on my behalf. He will teach you all things and he will help you remember everything that I have told you. See, he doesn't have a name for himself. Let me show you another thing about the Holy Spirit. All right? Okay, John 15, look at verse 26. That's the next chapter. But when the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, that is the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father. Now, your King James, use King James so you can see this word comes here. Who comes? But the Comforter is come, whom I will send to you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, who proceeds. He comes from him. Alright? He comes from him. So I said, he doesn't have a body of himself. No, he comes from the Father. But here's the thing about that aspect of the Holy Spirit. You're here? Here's the thing about him. Are you here?
Yes.
On the day of Pentecost, this happened. On the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came out of the Father. Do you remember also Jesus, that one time Jesus said, I came from the Father. Because the Father is the source of all things. Alright? So the Holy Spirit on this day of Pentecost, he came from the Father. All right? Now, oh God, will you understand this? Okay. Let me look up for a minute, because there's something I want to say, and I must be sure of this. Okay. When we go winning souls, Kelvin, and you meet people who are not born again, and you pray for them, and then Bible teaches they receive eternal life. Okay? Where does that life come from? Now, you see why I said I have to take time on this one? Because the understanding we have is that when I pray for a sinner, the Father releases life from heaven and he gets to the sinner. That's what most of us think happens, but that's not what happens. Now, the way you're looking at me, you are ready for it. Put up John 5 so I can show you something. It will connect to the Holy Spirit in a minute. John 5. Are you there? Verse 26. Look up, everyone. For as the Father has life in himself, so has he given to the Son to have life in himself. Do you see these two words here? In himself. I can simply say inherent life. I can simply talk to you about independence. Do you understand this? He is saying, when Jesus came, he said, I am come to give you life. He came with the equipment, with the ability, with resources, everything. He didn't have to say, Father, give me life so I can give. Mm-mm. He has it, he can give. But do you know, you that has life, you know what Bible says, the life you have received? He said, this is the record, 1 John 5:11. This is the record that God has given us life. Huh? Now, when it comes to that place, you think, oh God, are you here? When it comes to that place, you think you just given life. Oh, let me give you this. It's like having a well and then a vessel, a container. Let's take the well to be the life, and then you have the container. We think getting life from God is fetching from the well. No. Getting life from God is receiving a well. Okay. This is the record that God has given to us, eternal life. This life is in his Son. You're following? Life is in the Son. Look at the next verse. He that has the source. Do you see it now? You have the Son who is the source of life. So now, I don't just have life. I have the source of life. Let me say the Paul way. The first Adam was a living soul. The last Adam was a life-giving spirit. Now, I take after the last Adam. Yes, do you understand me now? It's also the reason why he told me to raise the dead. Do you understand it now? Yes. It's the reason why he sent to me, raise the dead. Because to raise the dead is to give their life back. So I talk life. You didn't hear me. I said, I talk life. Yes, nothing dies around me. Yes, huh? I talk life. Yes. I talk life. I talk life. I talk life. Nothing dies around me. Mm-mm. My words are life. The law of the Spirit of life is at work in me. And that law works in Christ Jesus. By the gospel, put up 2 Timothy. My God, I have to show you this scripture. Put up 2 Timothy 1. Alabasori bahatas. Are you here?
Yes, sir.
Let me show you something here in a minute. Verse 7. 2 Timothy 1, 7. Ooh, hallelujah. For God has not given us the spirit of fear. Is the Holy Ghost now? He has not given us the spirit of cowardice and timidity. The spirit I have doesn't cower. It is not afraid. I don't have the spirit of fear. You know what spirit he has given me? The spirit of what? Please switch to the New King James so I can run quickly on this one. The spirit of power, all right? Of power, of love, and of a sound mind. These are not three spirits. It's one spirit. It's one. But he's of power. He is of love. This sound mind here is wisdom. All right? So I'm not just walking in power, I'm walking in love. I'm not just walking in love, I'm walking in wisdom. I have come into the climax of God's fullness. Do you understand this now? Mm-hmm. Now, it's not done yet. Let's go to verse 8 because I'm going somewhere. Please follow how the apostle is talking now. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of the Lord, nor of me as prisoner, but share with me the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God. Quickly, please. Verse 9. Who has saved us? God who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace which was given to us in Christ Jesus before the time began. Verse 10. But has now been revealed by the appearing of Jesus Christ, who has done what, church? Abolished death. Death has been abolished. Huh? Who has abolished death and brought life and immortality. Hey, are you understanding this now? So don't let my physical body deceive you. Do you understand this? Don't let it deceive you. What dwells in me is life and immortality. Okay? Don't let it deceive you. Okay. Use the passion for this one. Verse 10. This truth is now being revealed, unveiled by the revelation of Jesus, our life giver, who has dismantled death, obliterating all its effect on our lives, and has manifested what? His immortal life where? See now? In us. Huh? Glory to God. So the point I'm bringing is this. Remember the analogy of the well, and then you have a vessel. Now, when we came to Jesus, the life we received, we didn't get it to fetch in a vessel. Now, in fact, look at John 4, so that he can tell you in his own words. John 4. Verse 13. Jesus answered, if you drink from Jacob's well, you will be thirsty again, because they were at Jacob's well. Eh? Okay. The woman replied, but if anyone drinks the living water I give them, if you drink the water I give you, please follow the teaching here. I gave you water. Jesus said, I have given you water. Then he said, if you drink this water that I give, watch what happens. If anyone drinks the living water I give them, they will never thirst again and will be forever satisfied. For when you drink the water I give you, it becomes a gushing fountain of the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Springing up, flooding you. Talk to me now. He said, you come to me, I give you water. Once you drink the water, you realize he didn't just give you water in a cup. He gave you a well. He gave you a fountain. And he said it becomes gushes, springing up, welling up. Glory to God. You see? Are you here? So you see, when I go preaching the gospel and a sinner says he wants to accept Jesus, and I pray, the life they get doesn't come from heaven. No. The life they get comes from the Jesus that dwells in me. It's the life giver that is in me that is giving men life. Are you hearing me? Oh yes. He is in me giving them life. Glory to God. And you know something? The same is true of the Holy Spirit. Okay? He's come to dwell in us in all his fullness. Okay? In all his fullness. Without measure. Finally, I showed you from, maybe I was explaining this thought from John 15, verse 26. Look at the Amplified, the classic edition. Hallelujah. I just sense you are walking into a season of the supernatural. I just sense it. You ready? Are you ready for what's about to happen? Some of the things that will happen with you, you cannot explain to man. You understand? Some very strange things. Okay? Strange. Look at this. But when the Comforter comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of Truth who comes, who proceeds from the Father, he himself will testify regarding me. See, I want you to see that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father. Alright? And on that day of Pentecost, he did it. The Father released him actually, and he came rested on each one of them. And then he was now in them. Alright? Now, he is in Kelvin, he is in Simon, he is in Kitoani, he is in Joy, he is in all of you. Fully in all of you.
Yeah.
Okay? All of you. He is full in all of you. And you know the next person, he is going to also emanate and be in another person.
Yeah.
Alright? So that's the aspect I want you to see. But the last line of thought is John 14:10. John 14:10, because he's not just come to stay, just to be occupying house and space. That's not why he has come. Alright? Look at the last part here. But the Father who lives continually in me, he does his works. He doesn't just dwell in me. He does things. And I want to submit to you that he does by your hands. You are his hands. Do you understand this? You are his legs. Yes. In other words, you are his suit. Yes. That's what, when you say you're baptized with the Holy Spirit, you are wearing him, he's wearing you. Yes. When we say you're growing into the stature of Christ, the analogy we have is of a man who just got this the engineers don't like it when I say aprons. But those aprons, you know, you get, and then maybe it's large size, alright? Mukono ni kubwa, mugu ni kubwa, and all this. You're just a baby and you're dressed in that. In the spirit, that's what you're dressed with. And you're just a baby. Growth means your heart is growing to fit that heart. And your legs are growing to fit it. There is a measure already, the stature already established. And all of us are growing into it. All right? You're growing every day. You're growing in your mind. You're growing in your thought. You're growing in your thinking. You're growing in all these aspects of the personality of Christ. So the Holy Spirit is not just in you just to live as a guest. He is in you to do something. He is in you, I dare say, for the supernatural. All right? So when someone comes to you and they need a miracle, quit sending them elsewhere. They came to the right person. Are you here? They came to the right person. Sometimes I find preachers also guilty of blaming God still for no reason. When they can't get a miracle, they tell the person, "Are you sure you have faith? Your faith is not a problem. You're here. Just bring the word." Glory to God. You've been made a miracle worker. Are you hearing me? Yes. While they are saying, "Miracle worker, promise keeper," that miracle worker has given me the gift of working miracles, not talking miracles. Working them. Right? I work them by the Holy Spirit. Glory to God. Okay? Now, Acts 10:38. Hallelujah. Man, am I saying so many things? You guys are writing and writing and writing. Look up for a minute. Who among you this morning, you know you are anointed of God? Let me see. You know you are anointed. Yes. That has nothing to do with all that the early church has taught us. I know you prayed and people fell under the person. Eve is anointed. That's not the part. Because people fall for different reasons. You understand? Yes. I can just, hello, you are here. I can just take high voltage, no more electricity like this, and put it on Kevin. And he will behave exactly the same. Will you say I'm anointed? It's electricity I used. You understand? Just this. Others just kizungu-zungu and they will fall. Others just love falling. They love the feeling of ashes taking them down. I'm really anointed. It's not really the sign that you're anointed. Do you understand me? Yes. You guys have come when the church has increased in knowledge. Oh, we used to go for the falling only. Yes. We were going for it. For that falling. You fall, and when you start, you realize same devils haven't left you. They fell with you. Same devils, they were just waiting for you to wake up and then they can join you. Glory to God. Let me try that again. Who among us, you are anointed? Now, I have taught you in the past, I said you are anointed with favor. Today I'm showing you another anointing that is on your head and in you. Okay. Abishai showed them 2 Corinthians 1 before I can read for you this one. 1 is in verse 19. So that all of you will settle it in your heart. Now, he who establishes us with you in Christ and has done what? Anointed us is God. Show them 1 John 2 verse 20. I want to mess up every kind of negative thought on this one. Look at verse 20. But you have what? You have an anointing, you and you and you and you. You have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things. This is a kind of anointing when you have, you don't show ignorance. Go to verse 27, same chapter. But the anointing which you've done what? Abides in you. But this word here, anointing, can also be replaced with the Holy Spirit. Use NLT, NIV, they'll switch it. You see. You see? You see, but you have received the Holy Spirit. You see? Why he switches it? Because of Acts 10 that I'm now want to read for you. So we can see now. Acts 10, 38, where we were. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with two things. The Holy Spirit. What else? Power. And when those two things come, he said he went about doing good and healing. Hallelujah. So I'm anointed with the Holy Spirit and with power. Okay? I'm anointed. I said I'm anointed. You're not as confident yet. I want to see some confidence. Say, I'm anointed with the Holy Spirit and power. And that means you can work miracles. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
The days of one man so are over. Now every child of God can work a miracle. Yes. Now we are walking into seasons where you don't have to go travel places to go see one prophet of God in Israel to rid you of your leprosy. No. You can just reach someone next to you there. If they are children of God, the same anointing is on them.
Hallelujah.
Talk to me now. If Paul would put anointing on handkerchief and aprons, and devils will leave people, handkerchief. You see, if you're casting out a devil and the devil has been playing tricks on you, you just remember that scripture and you're like, what? You mean you have more respect for handkerchief than for me? You know what messes people up is a lot of thinking. The handkerchief doesn't have all that. It's just anointing at work. Your mind is blocking a lot of things. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. Say again, I'm anointed with the Holy Spirit and power. So from today, the anointed Simon is at work.
Hallelujah.
Yes. So as I am a business, I'm a business person, I say, I'm an anointed business person. Anointed with the Holy Ghost and power. Do you understand what that means? It means if I sell something for you, hey, the thing that lives with it. Do you understand me? What if I was a teacher? And I'm teaching in front of these 60, 100 kids. All you see is a teacher professionally trained, but there's more. That is an anointed teacher. Do you understand this? So they're all 60 minutes and in class, these students are under the anointing of the Spirit. That's how I want you to start thinking from today. Yes. Okay? And if you're an IT guy, same thing. Okay? Same thing. What you do is a vehicle. What you do is a chariot. The real you can take many shapes. You understand me? Okay. Let me give you a quick example. Are you here? You are, what do you do? Loctician. I'm forgetting that word. He works on locks. Excellent work. Yeah, and a drive Uber. And then, Joy, what do you do? Yeah? IT. Let's stick with my footballer guy. He's playing football. Okay? And you? Accountant. Let me work with those. Accountant, you have someone playing football here. Let's say he was doing it for profession, just for the sake of this example, okay? So you have accountant, a professional footballer, an IT guy, an Uber driver, a loctician. Okay? Let's say Usla is a client. Okay? And let's say Usla loves to have dreadlocks, even though I've never seen her in one. Let's just assume she loves to have them. So Usla decides one day, I'm going to visit his shop for some locks, you know. You visit his shop. The man working on your head, Usla, is anointed with the Holy Ghost and power. The hands he's working on is anointed with the Holy Ghost and power. And let's assume Usla is not born again. An anointed man with the Holy Ghost and power, just touch your head. Worked on you for how long? 1 hour or so. And then when you were done, as you realize it was late. Oh, it's almost 8. Let me catch an Uber. Guess who came? Simon came to pick you up. Anointed with the Holy Ghost and power. And he drove you home. Oh, and you realize your laptop has a problem. You're reaching out to who? The IT lady here. Anointed with the Holy Ghost and power. Let's say she's a footballer. And then who is your teammate? An anointed person. What about when you're paid and you want to go bank? You meet an anointed person banking your money. Do you see how this is connecting? It's just a network of anointed men. See? Now that person, even if they're not born again, the environment we've been passing them on from one environment to another, it will affect them, I'm telling you. If we just add another ingredient of don't just work on their head for 2 hours without saying something, just mention something. As you're working on their head, you say, do you know the Lord Jesus? Say, mimi hizo story sipendangi. Anaingia gari ya Simon inawekwa worship. Anasema, hauna goma ingine. You understand me? And then he gets the IT man and something else enters there before you get to the accountant. Okay. So you see all these guys are bombarding you. The problem what we've done today now is that God should leave the church and become worldly. See the problem? They leave the church and now you can't tell the difference. They do exactly the opposite of scripture. They conform to the world. They adapt to the world. So the sinners have no example at all of what a Christian is like. So Timothy tells us, Paul talking to Timothy, he said, be an example of the believers and for the believers. Two things. An example among the brethren, and out there, you are a model for them who is a believer. Okay? That's what the Holy Spirit produces. Okay? So from today, if someone is sick at home and all that, before we can even call, lay hands on them. Yes. If you call me, I'll remind you of this teaching. I'll say, hey, listen to what I taught. Lay hands on them. Okay? The same Holy Spirit in me is the same Holy Spirit in you. Yes. There's no white Holy Ghost and black Holy Ghost. There's no super Holy Spirit and junior Holy Spirit. It's the same one. What he's able to do in me, he can do in Georges. Okay? You just have to allow him. Okay? In fact, Jesus put it even higher in this John 14. Show them Abishai, verse 12. Is it verse 12 or 11? He stretched it way farther. He said if something in verse 12 here, so you can see. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me. Do you believe in Jesus? He said, the works that I do, you will do also. Say, I will do his works. You must start believing it now. From now. Let it become your mentality. Don't think these are things for Pastor Ben. No. In Mark 16, when he said, these signs will follow believers, he didn't say pastors, apostles. No, believers. You believe, these signs are with you. One, you're speaking in tongues. Two, you are casting devils. Three, you are laying hands on the sick and they're getting well. When you take poison, you don't die. The last verse, you go preaching, power is present for signs and wonders. This is your life. When Jesus came, he made every one of us a soldier. And every one of us effective. Okay? Yes. So we want to walk into days where when we gather like the Corinth church, Paul said, I have an issue with you guys. Every time you come together, one has a psalm, another revelation, another a hymn. I love this church. Said, you guys, always you have a revelation. And Paul said, that's wonderful. He said, but do it in order. Let one speak, then another. Okay? Yes. You see, that's what I want now. Next time we gather, you tell us of what you've been doing at your workplace. Do you understand me? Yes. Because only Eve can talk the accounting language that I, a pastor, I can't speak. But she can relate with them in that level. You can relate with IT guys. Alright? Decide from today, no one will be in contact with me and not contact Jesus. Did you hear what I said? Yes. No one will shake my heart and not shake Jesus' heart. No one will be with the same environment with me and not know Jesus. All right? That's what the Holy Spirit does. You are taking him now to the world. Oftentimes, you don't have even to be preaching like I'm doing here on pulpit. Just from where you are, okay? Being you, walking in your fellowship with the Holy Spirit, you can affect the next person. Okay? Just affect the next person. A prayer, listen to me, a prayer is not powerful because you prayed loud. Okay? Now, what makes prayer work is not the volume, it's faith. Right? Did you have faith? As you prayed, it will be answered. Alright? You see, the day an unbeliever comes to you and they are sick, there is your door to get them born again. I said, that's your door. In campus, I had these roommates. He would go on Friday clubbing. Drink beer, all manner of things. Weekend, he would be lying down very sick. Saturday evening, he's still sick. We have classes in the morning. And he's thinking, nitakosa hiyo exam, I'm so sick. And I will say, you know, I have medicine. I'll lay hands on him. He'll get well. And then he's my classmate. We'll go to class. He's very well. But then he will forget again on Friday, get drunk again. I'll work another miracle on Monday. God is too patient. He's the only friend I had that is still not born again. To this day. I don't know whether he got born again. Okay? So the person you have next to you, allow the Holy Spirit to touch them. Okay? Allow him to do it through you. Glory to God. Now, I feel like speaking to your coming days. Okay? Just take a minute. Bow your head in a minute and talk to the Lord. Just talk to the Lord in a minute. Talk to him in a minute, in a way you do. Talk to the Lord in a minute. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Oh, sarada baka sombre de lekebo jahala kopreda sevelas. Mande ko protoko shahala baranda sopeletais. Manta kaprodia la kadaba sora prata kambalega bosata kaprata la mande kabahanda. Father, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. Eibara sora prakata la mande kopredia velka sopretai. Zebara kamande le kora prata kaprata lia mange le bosai. Eibara kambala sose le tarapadia. Abaka saria tala mongredia saika prataya. Oh, glory to God. Mando copreta legaro feria saparas. Aba lego sata caprata la mande carapasai. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this week. Barasata capranda kalia profilias kahandas. Abaila saita kapara. Oh, marika zailo rasefarias kambalatala. Jahanda makapora seketalas. Oh, maropa ria kambalezosa ria tela. Je prahas kombrahata le kombre delege boja handas. Abaga sata kaprata la mande le kobosata bahandas. Father, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you, Lord. Makapara sata kapranda. Shahanda bahos kehela pratas. Ebara seketa loria sonda kela paras. Abarasora plekres kanta paroska. Oh, glory to God. Makapasa yatabaha. Glory to God. You're walking in power these coming days. We are in the days of his power. The days of his power. The dominion of Christ is manifest through you. Bala kaprata kambra de la kabasaya. The supernatural is your world and your environment. Baya kaprata kaprando kubaha. Shabahanda bakataya. E makaprata kapaliata. Imbraskola hadas. Let the winds of miracles blow over your
your life. Baya kambra skola, ebaria skanda taikapala, ebara sakata, e la masonda rapaika, ebala soriatas, intakapaya, la koza handa, e balakaba, every miracle do you now. Let it manifest in the name of Jesus. Let it show forth in the name of Jesus. I decree healings. Baya kaprata. I decree healings in the name of Jesus. Marabara kasata kaprata lamanda. Eh makapa lapaya kapa. Thank you, Lord. 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 Hallelujah. 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 Lift your two hands seated like that. Lift your two hands. Lift your two hands. I want to bring something, some grace on your hands this afternoon. Certain grace is coming on your head and on those hands. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for your every child listening to me, Lord. Let your anointing rest afresh upon them now. In the name of Jesus Christ, favor will follow you wherever you go. In the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, I declare and decree you're walking in the miraculous this week in the name of Jesus. Oh, you're anointed with favor. Anointed with favor. Abundance is the order of your life. Makapara sata kapara. Eh, marapaga saliata. Where there was better, let best manifest. Bale kobris kahadas. Where there was enough, let more than enough show up now. Reba sakata prata. Eh, la makambre skailata. In the name of Jesus. Makapora sahadas. I pray for the grace of God over the work of your hands. Marabasaka taraparianda kapaya. Begin to increase supernaturally. Baya kambara sopataya. Ey bakata. I call resources on your behalf. Marabosakanda. I call resources on your behalf. Maya kambara solahatas. Let men relocate you. Let men fight you. Makapora sahanda. Begin to advance, to make progress by the Spirit. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In this year of scarcity, you will enjoy abundance. Makapara sakataya. When many are going down, you are going up. Marasora paikapala. Hey, masanda kapa. Yes, you are enjoying favor upon favor, increase upon increase in the marvelous name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Now, those of you who are doing business, lift your hands if it's business you're doing. Like Simon, who else is doing business? Kevin, lift your hand. Who is doing business? Who else? Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for these lifted hands. In the mighty name of Jesus, let favor locate them this week. Let the right men come their way this week. In the name of Jesus Christ. Yes, glory upon glory, favor upon favor. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are special. You are a strange being in your world. In the name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ. Collins, I want you to switch this thing so I can move liberally. And those of you who are now employed,